generous funding for first stages to the Promised Land, made possible by the Helen Bader Foundation. Working with community partners for over 20 years to support programs that help individuals and communities reach their greatest potential. MPTV is proud of this collaborative effort. For this, we thank you.
In 1969, Israeli Prime Minister Golda Meir visited 4th Street School in Milwaukee. This image appeared in newspapers. Several decades later, Milwaukee playwright Jonathan Gillard Daly saw the picture and it sparked an idea. What you are about to see, First Stage Theater's To the Promised Land, is the outcome of that idea.
Ruth?
Who is that?
It's Mr. Baker, Ruth. Open up.
What you doing here?
Open the door, Ruth.
Who you got with you?
Well, nobody. It's just me.
You got no cop there. Gonna take me away in handcuffs because I missed your class.
Open the door, Ruth. It's cold out here.
Wait a minute.
Are you gonna let me in?
How do you know where I live?
It isn't hard to figure out, Ruth. Your address is on the class roster, 615 Walnut Street. I just want to talk to you.
About what?
About the weather? About the Packers? What do you think I want to talk about?
I don't want to talk about nothing. That's why I'm here by myself.
Watching cartoons.
This isn't cartoons. This is Sesame Street.
I never heard of it.
You've never heard of Sesame Street? Where have you been?
Can I please come in? It's cold out here.
Wipe your feet first. I can't believe you haven't heard of Sesame Street.
Oh, I don't watch TV.
You don't know about Oscar the Grouch?
Nope.
Or the Count? Now the Count, he's smart. A good teacher. He's teaching me to count to 10.
You already know how to count to 10.
All the singing songs and dancing puppets, it's a lot more fun than your class, Mr. Baker. I gotta tell you.
Can I sit down?
Take off that coat first. Don't be getting the sofa all wet.
So where's your mom?
Working.
You know you haven't been in school all week? The suspension was only for 2 days. You know you're home?
I gotta go get Tyrone.
Who's Tyrone?
He's my cousin. I've been watching him while my Aunt Yolanda's at work. I'd be getting him right now if you wasn't keeping me here.
Look, Ruth, you just can't stay away from school. It's against the law. Now, I don't want to call the police on you, but I will if I have to.
So you are gonna take me away in handcuffs?
None of this had to happen if you just told the principal where you got the knife. He didn't want to suspend you, but you didn't give him a choice.
I don't want to talk about this.
You put other students at risk, Ruth. My students. Now tell me where you got it.
From my mama's drawer. My daddy left it there.
Well, why'd you take it to school?
I wasn't taking it to school. I was taking it to the corner.
What corner?
The corner. The corner where those high school boys hang out and wait for the bus. I just got tired of them trying to scare me. Giving me looks like I was a girlfriend or something. I just showed it to him, then I put it right back in my pocket. Then I get to school and all the third graders buzzing around. Oh, Ruth, she's got a knife. She's got a knife. Stupid little kids, it ain't their business.
You realize you scared those kids?
Well, those boys scare me. They scare me every day.
Now, what about your mom? Does she know about this?
You ain't gonna tell her.
She thinks you're in school, doesn't she? She goes off to work and you stay here and watch TV all day.
I'm sick of those boys getting in my way.
Well, then tell them to get out of your way.
That's easy for you to say.
Or take another route to school or find somebody to walk with you.
Where'd you come up, Mr. Baker?
Where did I come up?
Where are you from?
Well, here.
Oh, yeah? Right here on this block?
Well, no. Not in this block.
Where? Way out there where the white folks live? Let me tell you something, Mr. Baker. Boys that live down here, they're mad. They hang around that corner and get down on everybody else. They get on my case because I ain't as big as them. Someday, one of them's gonna get so mad that he'll slap me, or punch me, or worse. Anybody ever make you feel that scared? You don't know what it's like here. You'll never know. Hey, I'm watching that.
Okay, Ruth, I don't know what it's like here. I get in my car every day and I go away, but I do know this. You let these boys get to you, or you let this neighborhood get to you, and this world is gonna pass you by, and then you'll just be sitting here in the dark.
What if I wanna sit here?
You're smart, Ruth. You're really smart, but you don't know everything. Now, are you gonna let a bunch of boys tell you what to do?
What do you want me to say? What can I say to get you out of here? I've never had a teacher in my house before. Looking at all my things, seeing how I live, makes my skin crawl.
All you gotta do is tell me you'll be in school tomorrow and then I'll leave you alone.
All right, I'll be there.
You promise?
I promise, I'll be there.
And I want you to call Rita and get the homework you missed.
We don't have a phone.
You don't have a phone?
Mama says we can have food or we can have a phone. We don't have money for both.
Well, I'll call Rita and send her over here. Does she have a phone?
I don't know. How should I know? I can't call her.
All right. I'll find her, okay? Now, what are you gonna do?
I'm gonna watch Sesame Street.
Look at that. All Bert's friends on Sesame Street together. Oh, what a day. I finally.
Regina, you take Walnut Street from here to 10th. Hand these out till they're gone. Did you put up the posters?
One at the Settlement House, one at Shankerman's, and Mr. Finn put one up at school.
What about the Spitzbud?
I tried. No children allowed in the steam bath.
Never mind. We'll pass them out on 3rd Street the day of the meeting.
Goldie, I'm worried about my poem.
What's to worry about? Your Hebrew is perfect.
I keep forgetting it.
So do it for me now.
I can't. I'll forget it. I know I will.
That's why you practice. Let me hear it.
Im ein anili, mili. Im anila atmi, ma'ani. Im lo akshav, imitai.
That's wonderful. And remember your gestures. They're very effective.
What if nobody comes?
Why shouldn't they come? For 3 weeks, Roses has been showing the same movie. Everybody's seen it twice. More taffy from Shankerman's they don't need. From us, they'll get poetry, speeches, and songs for their nickel. All for a good cause.
You said you'd think of a name for us.
I have. The American Young Sister Society.
But I'm not your sister.
Of course you're my sister. My sister in the cause.
I think it's a very good name.
People take you seriously if you have a serious name.
Will you buy me a school book, Goldie?
You'll get help just like everybody else.
But this is for the poor people.
I have news for you, Liebling. We are poor. We're not starving, but we're poor. Papa can't give his chairs away. Mama's produce is rotting on the shelves. Everyone in this neighborhood needs help.
Have you written your speech yet?
What do I need written?
Mama says she should write it down.
Well, Mama's wrong. I speak from here. For that, I don't need a piece of paper. When I'm done speaking, they'll open their purses and they'll give us their pennies and nickels. And every child at school will get a book. You'll see. No more of this 10 students to a book. Who learns that way? One child, one book.
Regina, your mother is calling you.
She's helping me with the meeting, Mama.
Ah, the meeting. All this week, that's all I hear. Do you know what you are, Goldala? A kochleffel. That's what you are, a kochleffel. Always stirring things up.
Nothing in life just happens, Mama.
If only you worked this hard at the store.
Don't be late tomorrow, Goldie. It's Square Root's first thing.
I'll be there. You see, people notice.
For you to help me, is it too much to ask?
When you make me open the store, I'm late for school.
From 4 a.m, I'm at the wholesaler's. If you're not at the store, it doesn't open. What else can we do?
The truant officer's going to come after me again.
What does he know? Does he run a store?
It's not fair. It's humiliating. I come in late 2-3 times a week. I miss so much.
So you'll be a smart woman one day later.
I know you don't care about school.
School is for boys. Why do you want to be a boy?
I want to be a teacher.
Teachers aren't allowed to get married. Do you want to be an old maid? Another letter for you today.
From Shayna?
Are you knowing any other girls in Denver?
When's she coming home, Mama?
How would I know? She writes to your sister and not to me.
I miss her so much.
Oh, I know you do, Liebling. She'll be home when she feels better.
She's so far away.
She needs to breathe the mountain air. It'll make her lungs heal faster.
But when she comes home, would she get sick all over again?
Not if she takes care of herself. Not if she does good, clean work at the store instead of working at that cigarette factory.
Mama!
Oh, I know. Working in the store is beneath her principles. To her, I'm some kind of moocher, cheating my own people by selling them food to eat. I'm a parasite. That's what she called your mother.
She didn't mean you personally.
Did I raise her to be so fresh? And why do you take her side all the time? I'll tell you why. She's poisoned you with that socialism of hers. And now you are spreading it to Tsipka.
I come to the meeting, Mama. I'm gonna recite a poem.
Oh, this is what I mean. One daughter I have preaching socialism, another I have organizing meetings, and a third making a spectacle of herself in front of strangers. I'll never hear the end of this.
Mama, please.
Next thing, my people will be buying their food from Dupkin. Yes, down the street.
Please come, Mama. It'll be so much fun.
So, what does she say?
Are you standing up for yourself, Goldie? Are you shouting? Are you waving your fists?
Nothing much. Just the usual news.
Stand up to her, Goldie. Do you want to go to school? Then don't give in. You know you're right. Stand up to her. You can't let her win. Don't let her make you give up, Goldie. Don't let her.
She's still in the hospital?
It won't be long now. She says she misses us.
She misses you.
She doesn't want to be in the hospital, Mama.
She doesn't want to be home either, dirtying her hands selling food to people who don't wash. She's too good for that.
Please, Mama.
Well, she's too good to stock shelves and away sugar, but she'll roll cigarettes 12 hours a day because that's the work of the people.
The factory job got her money so that she could do her real work.
That factory job got her so sick, she's in a hospital. And what is this real work you're talking about? Stirring up trouble, that's worse.
She teaches English to people who can't afford lessons.
She's worse than the German Jews. Those high-education ladies with their fine hats and their silk gloves and their sewing classes and their cleanliness classes and their English classes. What do I want to speaking English like a native? Forget Yiddish, they say. You are in America now. Forget Russia.
Some things about Russia I wish I could forget.
Like the men and horses?
What are you talking about? You are too young to remember anything about Russia.
I remember the horses.
What is she talking about?
She's talking about the Labor Day parade last week, Mama. You were at the store.
I can't afford to close the store just because some people take a holiday. Now, what happened at this parade?
We were waiting for it to start. The police came by on horses. They were making a path so the men could march. Tsipka saw the horses and she started to cry.
Oh, Tsipkele, why were you crying?
She thought the policemen were Cossacks.
I thought they were gonna hurt us like they did back home.
I told her not to worry. Didn't I tell you not to worry?
Yes.
In America, they ride horses through town protecting people. In Russia, they ride through town killing Jews.
Something I already know you're telling me.
I'd rather be in America.
So who wouldn't rather be here? All I'm saying is, why do we have to forget where we come from? They don't even call Tipka by her own name in school.
I'm Clara.
Why Clara?
Because Mr. Finn can't pronounce Tipka.
He should learn. Ay, ay, ay. Clear off the table, girls. It's time for dinner.
Mama.
What is it, Golda Meir?
Will you and Father come to the meeting?
And how would it look if we didn't?
Who's there? Who's there?
Shh! It's okay. It's
oh, okay. My God!
No,
oh, my
no,
God!
Don't scream!
Get out of here!
Scream.
Get out of here!
Ruth, don't, please!
Get out of here!
It's Cliff! Ruth, Cliff!
It can't be Cliff! Cliff is dead!
I'm right here!
You're not here! You can't be!
I am here! You brought me here!
You went out!
I can't! Every time I try to get away, something pulls me back! I think it's you! You want me here!
I don't want you here! What I want a dead man in my house? You get out!
First, you gotta tell me why you keep pulling me back.
I'm gonna scream!
I'll just come back another time.
Get out of here!
You gotta talk to me!
Get out! Get out! Get out! Cliff! Cliff!
Oh, Ruth, Ruth, wake up, baby.
Cliff, leave me alone!
Oh, it's all right, honey. It's all right.
Where did he go? He was right there.
Cliff ain't here, baby. He's gone.
Cliff!
He's gone.
Alle Menschen seien Brüder, und in Taten und in allen.
Im ein Anili, Mili.
If I am not for myself, who will be for me?
Im nila atmi ma'ani.
If I am only for myself, what am I?
Im lo akshav emitai.
If not now, when? Just imagine how it would be if every student, if every one of your children had his or her own book in school. Everyone would have an equal chance to study, to learn, to go forward. You tell us every day, America is a land of opportunity. And you're right. Here we can make you proud of us. Here we can succeed. All we need is your help. Just a few pennies, maybe a nickel or two. If all of you help us, all of us will have what we need. Lo alecho ham locho ligmoyer.
It is not up to you to finish the task.
But you can help us to begin. And so we appeal to you. We know that pennies are so hard to come by. We know how much you sacrifice for us. But just imagine what it means to be learned, to be informed, to be armed with the tools of scholarship. In America, we all have that chance. In America, we are all members of the same family.
Mama!
Mazel tov!
I am
Last week my life had meaning. It was beautiful and so sweet. But now it's nothing, nothing without you, baby.
Ruth! Ruth! Mama, you scared me.
Oh! Where's Harold?
You scared me to death.
I said,
Where's Tyrone? Do you know what time it is?
Oh, no.
It's 7 o'clock at night. It's dark outside.
I fell asleep.
You were supposed to pick up Tyrone after you got out of school. Your Aunt Yolanda's been waiting on you.
Don't yell at me.
I'm scrubbing Mrs. Mayer's bathroom, and she starts calling, "Come down, Florence, come down." So I run down the stairs, and there she is, looking like she's seen a ghost. She's holding the phone like it's a poison snake. Poor lady probably never talked on the phone to no Negro before.
I didn't mean to.
It's Yolanda. You're not there, and she's 3 hours late for work. She's gonna get fired because of you.
I fell asleep.
So I tell Mrs. Mayer that I got to go.
You can't go, Florence. You can't. I got gas at 6. Don't you remember?
I'm sorry, I tell her it's an emergency. Well, if you leave me, Florence, don't bother coming in tomorrow. So now Yolanda and me both gonna get fired.
And I come home, and here you are. Taking a nap.
I'll go get Tyrone. Oh,
never mind. I gotta go see Yolanda and beg her to forgive me. Then she's gotta go to work and try to save her job.
And now I gotta go and beg for mine. What are you gonna do? Oh, Lord Almighty!
I'm sorry, ma'am. I didn't mean to frighten
you. Who are you?
Daniel Baker, ma'am. I'm Ruth's teacher. I was on my way home and I thought I'd just drop off her homework.
Why don't you have your homework? What's going on here? Ruth, I don't have time to sit here and wait you out. You tell me why he's bringing you your homework. Speak up, child. I can't hear you.
I've been absent all week.
All week?
I got sent home Monday and I just stayed. I picked up her on every day and then we just came here. That's the truth.
I better go. Ruth, I was gonna give you this morning, but you didn't show up.
What's this?
Well, it's an article about a very special visitor we got coming to school on Monday.
Who is she?
Well, she's a very famous woman. I want you to read this and write a report on it for Monday.
By Monday? That'll take me all weekend.
That should be easy for you. You ain't going nowhere. She'll get it done, Mr. Baker.
Thank you, ma'am. Can I give you a ride somewhere?
Oh, I'm going just a few blocks.
Well, it's pretty cold out there. I'd be happy to take you. I'll just clear out the front seat. It's a bit of a mess. I'll see you Monday.
This isn't over, Ruth.
My name is Golda Meir, and this is my story. I remember being hungry all the time. I was always a little too cold on the outside and a little too empty on the inside. I knew that life was hard and that there was no justice anywhere. I can remember standing on our porch in Kiev. My father held a hammer and nails. He was pounding boards across our windows and across the front door. Our house became so dark, but at least we were safe from the rocks and the clubs and the mobs of people. Day and night, they roamed our streets, pounding on our doors, looking for Jews. They called us Christ killers. They hated my father and mother and my sisters. And they hated me.
Told you I'd come back.
I don't want no ghosts coming around here. Why don't you just stay away?
You think I wanted to leave? You think I wanted to get shot?
You were the one running with that gang. What'd you think was gonna happen?
I was home that night. I was sitting on the front porch. It was too hot to go anywhere.
You were out with Tommy and Eugene.
Mama told you that?
She said you were out breaking windows, starting fires.
I wasn't doing anything but sitting on the front porch drinking iced tea. Why would I want to go out? It was crazy out there. Police all over the place, sirens going off, people hanging out on the streets, watching all of it, acting like it was a party, but it was more like a war, like a riot. Tommy and Eugene came up to the porch. They had some rocks. Eugene had a Coke bottle with the rag stuck in it. Smelled like gasoline. I told them I didn't want nothing to do with that. So they started up the alley to that paint store all night. They couldn't even break a window, let alone start a fire. But the police were on them in a second. They started running away, and I heard them screaming in the alley, so I ran out the door, and I shouted at them to come in the house, but then the cops came for me. So I ran back to the door. First thing I felt was my neck burning like I was on fire. Then I heard the shot.
Thought I was gonna faint, but I was still running. Couldn't breathe. I got to the door, another shot. Then I got inside, crawled through the kitchen, got to the sofa, couldn't move my legs. So cold. Hottest night of the summer, and I'm freezing cold. Lying on my side, couldn't get my elbow out from under my ribs, couldn't breathe, then I couldn't feel anything. And then I looked up. I mean, I was looking down and I could see myself lying there. Police coming in the back door, mama screaming, you standing in the doorway holding that little bear I got you at the state fair. Mr. Charles came in from next door, had a dishcloth and plate in his hand, blood running down his face. He'd been doing the dishes and his kitchen window blew up while he was standing there. This room was on fire with panic and screaming and flashing lights from the alley, but I just started drifting away from it. Everything quieted down. And then nothing. Just wanted to sleep.
I guess you got what you wanted.
This ain't no sleep. I keep getting pulled back here. You won't let me be. You want me to fight them boys for you, but you gotta do that on your own.
How do you know about
that? I know everything that's going on here, Ruth. Mama walks around the house at night. I call her name. She won't even look at me, but you? You won't leave me alone. What you want from me?
I want it back the way it was, when there was all this pain and hate.
It's always been like this, Ruth. You were just too little to notice it.
My ancient grandmother always drank her tea with salt. We would come and visit her in her shtetl. One night, we had been playing in a narrow lane near the Pinsker Oblota, the swamps that surrounded Pinsk, oceans of mud that we were told to avoid. On this night, suddenly out of nowhere, or maybe out of the swamps themselves, came the Cossacks on their horses. We hid to avoid them. They came galloping over our crouching, shivering bodies. After they were gone, we went crying to our grandmother and told her with quivering voices of our fearful episode. She sat quietly, calmly spooning salt into her tea, stirring and stirring. Finally, I asked her, "Grandmother, why do you put salt in your tea?" And she said to me, "I want to take the taste of all this into the next world." Golda.
Golda.
Hi, Mama.
What you doing up so late? It's almost midnight.
I got all this to do by Monday. Did Mrs. Mayer give you your job back?
Well, she let me out to Mrs. Brodsky for next weekend, so I guess all is forgiven.
I'm sorry I got you in trouble.
Are you sorry you lied to me? Well, I am dead on my feet. 6 o'clock gonna come early tomorrow.
You working tomorrow? It's Saturday.
The Edelmans. They throwing a big party for their boys' bar mitzvah. Gotta clean the house from top to bottom, make the hors d'oeuvres, serve the Morgan David, and clean the whole mess up by myself when it's done. Probably won't get paid any extra.
They take advantage of you.
Well, I am blessed to have a job. So now, I got Jews on the weekends, Catholics on Monday, Wednesday, Friday, and Lutherans on the off days. I serve all faiths.
You spend more time in other people's houses than you do in your own.
Well, it's a living.
Do you ever wish you were back home?
Home where? Alabama?
Yeah.
That's a wily question coming at midnight. Is home where you born or where you live?
You ever think of going back?
Come on, Ruth, it's late.
Do you miss it?
I suppose I do, every now and then. It was a good life. Bit different from here, life on the farm. everything we ate, we grew. Asparagus, peanuts, sweet potatoes so big they look like watermelons in my hand. And lots of things we grew got canned for the winter. We had peaches, corn, okra, tomatoes. Anytime we want, summer or winter. And Mama made our clothes, too. She could make a dress out of a burlap sack, look like it come out the Sears catalog.
Why did you leave?
Well, I met your daddy. He was aching to come north. He didn't want to be a sharecropper like his daddy. He didn't want no part of working other people's land. He wanted land of his own. He heard about all the good jobs up north. Factories and mills, defense plants, all that work after the war. Good money. So, we got married and we left. Drove away one day in this rusted out old car with holes in the floor. We could have walked to the north faster.
Then Daddy left.
Oh, not right away.
But he left.
He didn't want to. I didn't want him to. He spent a year looking for a job, got nothing except for one day's work at a mill. The union workers went on strike, so they were looking for men to take their place. They didn't care what color they were, they just needed bodies. The first day he was there, the union men attacked the mill and burnt it to the ground. They called it a labor dispute. But your daddy knew better. If he hadn't run away, it would have turned into something else.
What do you mean?
Saw my first lynching on that trip, no. Black man looked sideways at a white woman. That night, he's hanging from a tree. Nothing we could do about it. I'm starting to remember things I've been trying to forget. I got to go to bed.
How did we end up living here?
615 Walnut's the only place that rent to us. Crammed in here with all the other black folks. First week we were here, your daddy found us a nice place in a good neighborhood. Landlord was all smiles. You remember what your daddy looked like?
No, not really.
Well, he was a good-looking man. But he was a black man with light skin. Lots of white folks thought he was one of them. So this landlord was all set to rent to him. Your daddy told him, I'm coming back tomorrow with my wife so I can show her the place. Next day, that landlord took one look at me. He looked your daddy right in the eye and said, there must be some mistake. I never met you before and this place is rented. So we settled for 615 Walnut. And we're still stuck here. Daddy went south, because at least he knew where he stood there. He tell me, up north they smile and make promises, but you could see the hate in their eyes. Daddy never could understand people saying one thing and meaning another.
But why didn't he take you with him?
Because I didn't want to go. I didn't want to get uprooted all over again. So he sent us money every week, year after year, till the day he died. He kept us going. Took me a long time before I got enough work cleaning houses to get by. Without your daddy, we never would have made it.
You never told me that.
No, you never asked. And I never wanted you to worry. Your daddy loved you. And Cliff. He hated being away from you. But he was taking care of his mama, too. His daddy dropped dead in the fields picking cotton, so your daddy took his job so his mama wouldn't get shoved off the farm. He sent us money, and he'd visit us twice a year, once in summer, once in winter. Kept that up for years. He took care of all of us. You just never knew.
You never even told me how he died.
I got a telegram one day, 2 days after I got his last check.
Tell me how he died.
He got an infection in his ear.
You don't die of that.
Well, you do if you don't get to the doctor fast enough.
How old was he?
39.
Why didn't he go to the doctor?
I don't know why he didn't go. Baby,
I got to go to bed. Don't stay up too late. You got all day tomorrow to finish that.
She knows. She knows why he didn't go. So why won't she tell me? What is she afraid of?
When I was little, it never occurred to me that I would ever leave here. This was home. It wasn't much to look at. It was hot in the summer and drafty in the winter. But I felt comfortable here. As I got older, I realized that the only way to stand up for what I believed in was to leave, to go my own way. If I was ever going to accomplish anything, I couldn't do it from within these four walls. I had to prepare for my life, just as my parents had prepared for the long trip from Kishinev to Milwaukee. And this journey is one you have to take step by step. You start out with small steps, from here to the door, from the door to the street. And over your life, you travel a long, long way. But it starts right here.
Now, what did I do that was so bad?
What did you say to him, Mama?
Who are you talking about? I don't know who you're talking about.
You know who? Mr. Goodstein.
Such a mensch, Mr. Goodstein. So mature, so successful.
So old. He's as old as father.
Who's old? Nobody's as old as me.
I'm talking about Mr. Goodstein, father.
Oh, Goodstein, such a mensch and a good businessman.
He's young enough to be our son. He's barely 30.
I'm 14.
He's polite, he's successful, you could do worse.
He stares at me when I'm stocking the shelves. I can't even concentrate on what I'm doing. I can feel his eyes looking me over from head to toe.
You're exaggerating.
What did you say to him?
Can I help it if I brag a little? I just want what's best for you.
You want what's best for you?
Don't get fresh with your mother.
I don't want to marry Mr. Goodstein, father. Get that right out of your head, both of you.
We want to find someone dependable, someone to provide for you.
I don't want to be provided for. I can provide for myself.
What is this nonsense she's talking?
No one manages on their own. You need a good, strong man. You'll be out of school soon. Then what'll you do?
Do you think I'm going to stop at high school?
Oh, not this again. High school isn't enough for you. It is for everyone else.
You want me to settle down to a nice little life with Mr. Goodstein or whoever you pick for me. But I am going to college. I'm going to be a teacher.
You're going to be an old maid.
I didn't come to America to be somebody's housekeeper.
You came to America because we brought you here. We wanted to give you a better life. And this is how you repay us?
You couldn't do better than Mr. Goodstein.
He's a German Jew, Mama. One of those do-gooders you've always avoided. And now you want me to marry one.
The mouth on this one!
Shayna was right about you. You're not really interested in my welfare. You just want to marry me off.
And who are you going to marry? One of those socialist troublemakers? You'll end up in jail.
Maybe I won't ever get married.
Shame! Shame on you!
You'll break her heart! Don't you care about that?
I can't stand this. I can't, not a minute longer.
Stand up to her, Goldie. If you buckle under, you'll regret it. Remember what you wrote to me. Only those who dare. Only those who have the courage to dream.
Only they can ever accomplish anything of meaning.
People are always saying, is it realistic? Is it worth trying? Well, I say, what's realistic? Is it standing still and doing nothing? That's not realism. That's death.
Goldie, I've only got a minute.
Regina, I couldn't have a better friend in the whole world.
I'm crazy, that's what I am. If we get caught, they'll whip me till I'm black and blue.
We won't get caught.
You've got to be ready before the sun comes up. Otherwise, we'll be seen.
I'll be ready if I have to stay up all night.
Now listen carefully. At 4 a.m, look for me standing under your window. You throw down your bundle. After the sun comes up, I'll ride the trolley to the train station. I'll put your bundle on the green bench underneath the clock. Then I'll come for you as always, just like it was any other school day. We'll walk to 4th Street. Then I'll turn north to go to school, and you turn south to the train station. You pick up your bundle there,
green bench underneath the clock,
and wait for the train.
I will.
And don't be late.
The train to Denver was late. I stood alone in the depot for an hour. My heart was pounding in my chest. I was skipping school. I expected a truant officer to take me away at any moment. But no one came for me. As the train approached, I felt the tears come. I held them back. I buried my fear as deep down as I could push it. I stepped onto the train and into my future. I would go to Denver. I would study. I would live with Shayna.
What do you want, Ruth?
I just want Mama to tell me the truth.
So you're gonna run away. How's that gonna help?
Stop asking me questions.
Why are you keeping me around here? I'm the one who should be getting out, not you.
I remember the first day you came home dressed like that, scared Mama to death.
She thought I joined the gang.
Can you blame her? All you boys dressed the same, wearing sunglasses, even when it was raining.
The commandos weren't a gang. We were a police force for our people. Who was protecting us? Not their police. When we went out marching, they were busting our heads along with everybody else.
Is that why you ran from the police that night? Why didn't you just let them catch you? What would they have done to you? They would just call Mama to come bail you out.
Mama was through bailing me out.
You'd still be alive.
She already bailed me out once.
When was that?
You want to see?
It's your father. What a lie to say this.
I paid back the bail money. I got a job.
I knew all this marching was going to get you into trouble, but you wouldn't
this
listen.
This wasn't even a march. We were having a rally.
Disturbing the peace? Unlawful assembly?
They had a permit.
Also, why am I leaving work to bail you out of jail?
I mean, because one kid, a 12-year-old girl, stepped off the sidewalk and onto somebody's front yard. They were just waiting for somebody to do that, so they hauled us in.
You are just looking for trouble, especially dressed like that.
It's our uniform, so the people know how to find
so
us.
So how can you say you are not looking to start a war with a name like the Commandos?
Nonviolent protest.
Oh.
But Dr. King preaches, we don't want anybody getting hurt.
To them, you are just another gang club. And you don't care that you are scaring me to death.
I'm doing this for you, Mama, and for all of us. You want to be able to live where you want, don't you? In a nice little house of your own with a yard and not some dump nobody else wants.
You don't like this house. You can get out.
Don't you want to be free?
I want to be safe.
I'm gonna be right back out there until they change the laws.
Or until they kill you. This happens again. Don't expect me to bail you out.
She never understood. She never even tried.
You didn't run from the police at all, did you?
Why would I run? I didn't do anything wrong.
Those bullets weren't meant for you.
Those bullets were meant for a black man. Just turned out to be me.
Why did Mama tell me you ran?
Because that's what they told her, and she believed them. She knew she'd never get to the truth, so she made up her own. Was it the first time?
What's that supposed to mean?
Ask Mama sometime how Daddy died.
What?
Just ask her, that's all I'm saying.
She lied to me.
She thought she was protecting me.
From the truth?
She thought you were too young to know.
So she lied? I'm sick and tired of being lied to. I want the truth.
Then maybe you ought to stop running away and start asking questions.
Why'd you put that uniform on in the first place? You knew they'd come after
you. You wanna know why I joined the commandos? One night I was shooting baskets on a playground. Sun was going down, and all of a sudden things got crazy. Lights, sirens, people screaming. We saw this crowd turn the corner and start running at us. Somebody yelled to me, run! I never even had time to take off, and I felt something hard smash me in the face. Next thing I know, I'm on the ground, and this cop is standing over me, holding his billy club right over my head. I could see his badge. Part of it was covered up with black tape, so I couldn't see his number. Then he stood up straight and said, run, nigger! Why don't you run? And then I knew he wants me to run so he can shoot me down. So I just laid there, gravel and dirt inside my mouth. I'm shaking, my heart's pounding, but I didn't move. After he left, I walked the 5 blocks of Freedom House, and I marched right in that door, and I said, I want to be a commando. When you know something is wrong, you gotta make it right.
Going home. Ruth, we're gonna be late for church.
Go ahead, ask her.
Ruth, I'm talking to you. Now, come on.
I'm not going.
I don't remember you having a vote about this.
My report is due tomorrow and I have a lot left to do.
Ask her.
What's more important than church?
Ruthie!
Just go! You take some of that bass out of your voice, young lady. Now, what's on your mind?
You don't want to know.
I don't want to spend this beautiful day tiptoeing around your attitude. Now, you tell me, what is it?
Ask her.
If I ask you something, will you tell me the truth?
Of course I will.
How did Daddy die?
Died of an ear infection. I told you that.
That's not the truth.
You don't die of an ear infection.
Well, your daddy did.
How did he die?
He was having breakfast one morning in this diner. Some folks from the north were outside signing up Negroes to vote. Bunch of white folks got riled up, came into the diner and started pushing people around. They're going after this old lady and a little girl and your dad. Your dad. Your daddy stepped into it. White folks took him outside, beat him up. Bad. Couple days later, his ear swelled up. His mama tried to get him to go to the doctor, but he didn't want to take off work. Finally, it got so bad, my uncle put him in his car and drove him to the hospital. They wouldn't look at him. He was the wrong color. So they drove 2 hours to Montgomery. But by then it was too late. He died in the car.
Why didn't anyone go to the police?
The men who beat him up were the police.
What happened to the old lady and the little girl?
They got away safe. My folks didn't care. They had your daddy.
He saved 2 lives. He was protecting the people, just like Cliff was. Cliff learned that from Daddy.
Who you been talking to?
I'm just paying attention. I'm finally starting to notice things.
I don't know what you're trying to do, Ruth. Stirring all this up. I'm going to church. You do whatever you want.
So what will you do now? Are you still going to run away?
I don't know. You did.
I had somewhere to go. At least I thought I did.
So do I.
So don't listen to me. You want to go forward, fine. But first, you have to go backward in case you missed something. Now pay attention. What is the future of our 20th century society? I'll tell you. Our society is a pyramid. The upper class is at the top. The Gentiles do business only with them. The rest of us are crowded together at the bottom. The farmers the handymen, the workers in the factories. There's no work for us because the Gentiles are afraid to hire us. We have to turn that pyramid upside down so that all of us can share in the bounty of America. We can till the soil. We can build the machines. We can create. We have our future in our hands. We are ready. We are willing and we are able. Papa, what are you doing in Denver?
I sent for him.
You betrayed me?
Now listen to me. I told you to stand up to Mama. I didn't know you were going to run away from her.
But you took me in, Shayna. I thought you were on my side.
I am on your side. Denver is not where you should be.
But I'm learning here.
You're missing school, and when you're there, you're too tired to pay attention.
What about the league?
What is she talking about?
We formed a young Zionist league here, Papa. Our meetings are at night in my kitchen. We stay up all hours organizing, debating.
I learned more there than I ever could in school.
Where do you think we'd be without school? We studied, we worked hard. Some of us even graduated from college. We're 10 years older than you. You always used to complain about Mama keeping you out of school, and you're missing more class here than you ever did at home. You need to be in school, not standing on street corners in the middle of the day making speeches.
You sound like Mama.
Golda. Come home. Your mother is sick with worry.
Go home, Goldie. It's where you belong.
Why are you in such a hurry?
Because the world won't wait for me to grow up, Father. There's a war coming.
You want to be a teacher, don't you? Do you think you can do that if you're not serious
about
school?
You want to go to school, you go to school. High school, college, whatever you want. Just come home.
They were right. You have to find your own way, but you don't have to do it alone.
Goldele, Goldele, was wird sein der Tachlis von dir?
But you can't expect the people who love you to ever stop worrying.
What will be the end of you?
I'll be fine, Mama. You didn't worry when I raised money for school books.
That was adorable. This is politics.
It's what I want to do.
I won't stand in your way. You don't stand in front of freight train.
At least you understand.
You understand, I don't know. But I do know you're stubborn.
I got that from you.
Someday you will find what you're looking for. Then you will be home. But it may be a long way from here. Before you go, be sure you know the price you have to pay.
Who's there?
It's Mr. Baker, Ruth. Can I come in?
Go ahead, Ruth. No more talk of running. Now you have some place to go.
Sorry, I would have called first, but you don't have a phone.
I know. It's all right.
So how's the report coming? Did you finish it?
I did.
Good. Listen, I talked to the principal. I explained what happened to you on the corner, and he's willing to take the suspension off your record. Of course, I had to make a little deal with him.
A deal?
Well, he thinks it would be a good idea for an eighth grader to introduce Golda Meir at the assembly tomorrow, and he asked me who I thought could handle it.
Oh, no. You didn't.
I think you should do it.
What do I say?
Say what's in your heart. You're meant for this, Ruth. You can't pass up what you're meant to do. See you tomorrow.
From the time I was little, I had this flame inside me. I was afraid that if I ever stopped moving, that flame would go out. But it didn't. It just got stronger and brighter. And so it will with you. If you feed it with learning and living and doing good, it'll never go out.
Going home, going home, oh, to the promised land, ain't gonna be alone. hand. Lord, gonna make me strong. Fill my voice with song. Guide me with your loving hand. Going home to a world of our own. Gonna make the people understand. Gonna make the people understand.
I've been quiet so long. I don't even remember what it sounds like to speak. I let people tell me what to do. They want you to think they're so big and so cool, but they're not. We ain't gonna let you walk by here. What do you think of that? We're gonna tell you where you can go, when you can go. And I listened to them. I told myself, I don't care. I went home, I turned on the TV, loud enough so I couldn't hear what I was thinking. And I let my mind get quiet. That's no way to live. Then I read about Golda. She talked to me. She's been through all this. She's had people push her around and call her names. They tell her, stay where we put you. Where we can find you and keep you quiet. But that's not life. That's not living. Is that realistic, she said? Standing still and doing nothing? That's not realism. That's death. We don't want to hurt anybody. We don't want to take anything away from anybody. We just want to live where we want. In nice little houses with front yards and flowers in a garden. We don't have to let ourselves get stuck in a place where there's no fresh air. And no green trees. And no hope. Cliff didn't die for that, that we should stop hoping. My daddy didn't die for that. You owe something to the people that came before you, the people who fought and died for what you have now. Goldie taught me that. And daddy. And Cliff. I'm not gonna let you down. Gonna make you proud, you hear me? I promise. I promise.
It isn't really important to decide when you are very young just exactly what you want to be when you grow up. It is much more important to decide on the way you want to live. It seems to me that is sufficient, and maybe what you will be is only a matter of chance.
Cliff! Cliff!
There she is!
We were all sitting in the gym when she walked in. She was wearing this beautiful jacket. It had a skirt to match. It was golden white with these big black waves in it. She looked like a zebra. And she just glowed. All these men in suits came walking in behind her. All of them looking all nervous. The third graders made a circle around her. She sat down in this little chair. They put a paper crown on her head. She was smiling and laughing the whole time like she didn't have a care in the world. We gave her roses that we made out of cloth. Then the whole school sang to her. She blew us kisses. She touched every hand that she could reach. Mr. Baker went up to her and I saw him point to me. Next thing, I'm standing right next to her and she's talking to me. She asked me about the paper I wrote, so I gave it to her. She folded up and put it in her pocket, and she said she'd read it on the plane ride home. And then she hugged me. Then her figure lit up with all the cameras flashing. All the men in suits moved away. And then she was gone. She disappeared, like it was all a dream.
Yeah, but it was real.
I'm sorry I was so mad at you.
Sorry I left you on your own.
Nobody understands me like you do.
Just talk to him like you talk to me. You'll be fine.
What am I gonna do without you?
You remember when I took you to the 4th of July parade?
Oh, yeah. I was so scared. All those people.
Grown-ups as tall as trees bumping into you like they were gonna crush you like a twig. You couldn't see anything. So I lifted you up, and you stood up on my shoulders, and you saw all the horses and all the bright red wagons with the lions inside.
And that organ playing music, steam coming out.
The calliope.
That music was so sweet and so sad, like it was crying. How'd you hold me up all that time?
You were light as a feather. I just wanted to make sure you got a good look at everything.
It was like looking at the world from the top of a mountain.
Whenever you feel small, you just pretend you're standing on my shoulders. Make sure you get a good look at everything.
I will.
I'll be watching you.
I know.
Goodbye, Ruthie.
Goodbye, Cliff.
Over 40 years ago, I sat on the floor of this gym just as you are today. I was Ruthie then. That was a long time ago. To you, I must look as old as Golda Meir looked to me on that day. But I'm still Ruthie on the inside. And I still love to tell stories. I'd love to share one with you now, if I may. Once, there was a lazy little frog who liked nothing better on a hot day than to lay out on a rock and feel the sun on his belly. So one morning, he left his lily pad underneath the shade of the palm tree and swam out to the middle of the river. There he saw a large piece of driftwood jutting out into the water, and he thought, what a perfect place to do a little sunbathing. So he slammered onto the driftwood, lay out on his back, feeling the warmth of the sun on his belly. Soon enough, he fell fast asleep. Eventually, he was awakened by the sound of a crow laughing at him. Frog opened his eyes and looked towards the shore. But the palm tree underneath which lay his lily pad was nowhere to be found. All he could see was miles and miles of sand, and Frog cried out, where's my palm tree? Who took away my lily pad? Crow laughed and laughed. Where did you think you were, Frog? You are on the river. The river is always in motion. The current has taken you far away from that palm tree. You may never be there again. Learn and be aware. Call! 40 years ago, I sat where you are. And 100 years ago, little Golda sat in that very spot. Time rushes past in the blink of an eye. Just like the water on a river, we are all floating along in the current of the river of life. Tomorrow, we will have moved down that river far away from where we sit today. The crow had good advice for us. Live. Learn and be aware. Life may take you far away from where you started, but your home will always be here, close to your heart. For within you, if you have the courage and the patience to search for it, is your very own promised land. May the heavens bless your journey and the stars light your way.
generous funding for First Stages to the Promised Land, made possible by the Helen Bader Foundation. Working with community partners for over 20 years to support programs that help individuals and communities reach their greatest potential. MPTV is proud of this collaborative effort. For this, we thank you.
Hello, I'm Joanne Williams. The play you've watched is historical in nature, but its central characters, Ruth and Goldie, lived decades apart. The fictional Ruth attended 4th Street School, which became Golda Meir School. It was named after the former Israeli Prime Minister. The Goldie character, a dramatic recreation of a teenage Golda, lived in Milwaukee from 1906 to 1921. She attended 4th Street School, too. The years she spent in Milwaukee were her formative years. So how does a girl in Milwaukee grow up to be Prime Minister of Israel?
Golda came to this country when she was 8 years old from Russia. The part of Russia that she was born in would now be the Ukraine. It's near Kiev. They're coming here really for the opportunities in the United States, and at the same time really fleeing really harsh persecution. And her maiden name was Goldie Maybovich. And when Golda came here at 8 years old, her father had already come several years prior. He was renting a room, a single room, in another family's apartment. It's around the 4th and Walnut, 5th and Cherry areas. And this is a huge Jewish neighborhood at this time period. And all five of the Maybeviches are living in that single room. So Bella Maybovich says, you know what, I've never run a grocery store, I've never been a business person, but I'm going to start my own grocery store, and she does, to the rest of the family's chagrin. Especially Golda's. I think in the play you definitely see that Golda wants to be in school. She knew she wanted to be a teacher. She knew she needed to be in school to do those things. And she went to 4th Street School, and that school gave her a basis in English. That school gave her, you know, friends. It gave her a way of building leadership. And I think that she sees the power of school and the power of community in doing that. And her parents didn't get that. They just didn't understand why a girl would need this kind of education and training. Teachers didn't get married at that time, and they felt that this was a really hard life that their daughter was choosing for herself. So she enrolls herself in high school. She enrolls herself in North Division High School against her parents' wishes. Her mom at the same time starts kind of shopping around for a husband for her and finds a guy. And Golda's 14 and finds a nice 30-year-old. So Golda and her parents get into this kind of tremendous fight about this, and she borrows some money from some friends, and her friend Regina helps her, you know, get on this train. Like, basically she dumps her her suitcase out the window at night, and she runs away to her sister in Denver. And Shayna has moved to Denver because she had tuberculosis, and Denver is where people are going for these clear air, you know, cures. She does go to school for a little bit, and it's really there that she's introduced to Zionism, this desire to have a Jewish state in Shayna's salon. So while Golda was in Denver, she met a very nice man named Morris Meyerson. And now Morris was not one of the political rabble-rousers that came over to Shayna's house. Morris was really in touch with the finer things. He loved the symphony, he loved museums, and he introduced Golda to all of these things. So she comes back to Milwaukee. Her parents basically say, come back, we'll let you go to high school. She comes back, she finishes school, and really feels that, you know, above all else, even though, you know, at first it's this driving passion to be a teacher that's really driving her, that this desire for a Jewish state is really the thing that's pushing her the most. And she joins an organization called Pole Zion. And she ends up becoming this active, ardent force. One of the first things she does is she decides she wants to go and speak and really address the people. And where do you address the people? You address them outside of synagogue during the high holidays. And this is, again, not what a girl is doing at that time period. Her father gets in this huge fight with her. He says he's going to pull her home by her braids. He goes and he hears her speak and says, I don't know where she gets this from, but is totally in awe of her speaking ability. And that really is one of the things that serves her well for the rest of her life. So Golda and Morris got married, and so she became Golda Meyerson. And throughout the early part of her political career, she was known as Goldie Meyerson. And in the 1950s, after the creation of the State of Israel, David Ben-Gurion, who's the first Prime Minister of Israel, said, you know, you need a name that doesn't sound like it's out of the diaspora. You need a name that sounds like it's Hebrew. And so he coined the name Meir. Meir means to illuminate, and he thought it was this fabulous pun. You have Golda to illuminate. And so that's how she got this name. And it works for her. So in 1969, she becomes the Prime Minister of Israel. She's the first woman to serve in this office. She's the fourth Prime Minister in total. And she's actually only the third woman internationally elected to lead a country, which is kind of an impressive achievement if you think about, you know, this is a graduate of North Division High School. This is the only Milwaukeean, the only Wisconsinite elected to lead a country. In the United States, she is universally beloved, especially in Milwaukee. That this is someone that shows, you know, that can-do attitude, that you can do anything. There's really a sense that this is Golda. You know, Golda was a part of Milwaukee, and Milwaukee was part of Golda.
Golda Meir's connections to Milwaukee extend beyond 4th Street School. She's still remembered on a personal level.
My father knew Golda Meir when she was a girl. He was involved with the Labor Zionist School in Milwaukee, which was an after-school Jewish school. And Golda Meir became a volunteer teacher at that school. And I think she was probably 16, 17 years old. And he knew her from then on. And she, even in some of the books, says that Isidore Tuchman was her mentor. When Golda subsequently came to Milwaukee as a representative of the Labor Zionist movement in then Palestine, before there was a State of Israel, she stayed at our house. We had an extra bedroom, mine. And so she took my bedroom, and I could always point to the bed and say, Golda Meir slept here. I also remember actually sitting on her lap while she told stories about her life in Palestine at that time. I remember her coming to Milwaukee on several occasions after that. My wife and our kids made several trips to Israel, and one time we called and she invited us to come to the, at that time she was already the Prime Minister. And we came in, and she greeted us and very happy to see us and how our everything was in Milwaukee. Well, in Israel, if you come to somebody's home, you don't leave without eating. So we had to have coffee and cookies. And I poured the coffee and put the sugar in, and I took one swallow, and I looked at my wife. She took one swallow. I broke out into a cold sweat because it was salt. It wasn't sugar. I didn't know exactly how you tell that to the Prime Minister. So I figured, you know, keep your mouth shut, drink less, and let it go. 2 years later, she said, "Why didn't you tell me there was salt in that sugar bowl?" And here, this is a Prime Minister who is dealing with all kinds of things going on in the world and the trials and tribulations that a Prime Minister of Israel has, and ended up by remembering that. And that's the type of person she was. She remembered everything. She remembered everybody. She had a fantastic mind and a fantastic soul.
The character of Cliff, Ruth's brother, brings to life the open housing marches of the late 1960s. Cliff was a member of the Commandos, a group of young African-American men who served as a security force for the citizens taking part in the open housing marches. Here's a summary of that tumultuous period.
What we call the modern civil rights movement took place during the 1950s and 60s. Almost 100 years after the Civil War. Many protests took place in the South, but not all of them. The battlegrounds included cities as well. Black Americans who'd migrated from the South, searching for better opportunities, found barriers to their advancement in the North and Midwest as well. Protests and demonstrations were held in support of better jobs, better schools, open housing, and the right to vote as people of color sought their piece of the American dream.
The black man wasn't equal to the white man in the 60s. You know, the white man had freedom to live any place he wanted to as a man, but the Negro couldn't.
Milwaukee had its share of protests, most notably the marches for open housing, which attracted national attention, but there were other important issues as well. In 1964, attorney and state representative Lloyd Barbie, former nun Marilyn Moorhauser, and members of MUSIC, the Milwaukee United School Integration Committee, launched an offensive against the Milwaukee Public School System's efforts to desegregate. MPS was busing black students to all-white schools, but keeping the black students isolated from their white schoolmates.
Bringing African-American kids from the black community to white schools and just simply isolating them in one given spot, not allowing them to intermix and intercommunicate with the European students throughout the school system. That is just as bad as the racial or separate but equal doctrine that we have been practicing for some 60 years.
Mr. Barbie, how long do you intend to keep this protest up?
Well, we intend to keep it up until we have convinced the school board and the citizens of the city that construction for segregation must end.
I'm gonna keep on walking, keep on talking, walking up the
freedom. The school desegregation battle would continue into the 1970s and 80s. Meanwhile, another pressing issue came to the forefront, the need for open housing.
My brother comes back from Europe in the Air Force, decides he wants to buy my mom a house, then he's going back to England. Took her up on Capitol Drive, there's a house out there with a for sale sign in front of it, and he goes up in uniform and he knocks on the door and inquires about the house. And the lady tells him very bluntly, "We don't sell to niggas."
The African American community had tripled in size between 1950 and 1960, and grown again by 1967. But the opportunities to rent beyond a certain restricted area didn't increase. And the open housing campaign was not so much so that people could live in Brookfield or Mequon, it was so people could live on 27th Street.
Vel Phillips, the first woman and African American on Milwaukee's Common Council, proposed an open housing law and was outvoted 18-1.
It's bad enough to have to deal with a bigot, but when you got a dumb bigot,
we have tried every means possible to bring fair housing legislation to the city of Milwaukee.
Father James Grappi became an advisor to the NAACP Youth Council in 1965. A native Milwaukeean, he was also instrumental in the school desegregation fight. The Youth Council began protesting for open housing. Squire Alston was one of the NAACP's youth commandos.
The commandos were a police force that we put together to protect the leaders of the marches and the speakers and the people that were actually doing a march.
That was the philosophy of the commandos. We're not going to mess with you. We are going to protect these people behind us, okay? But no, we are not nonviolent. If you attack us, we will not ball up in a little knot and let you do whatever you want to do. We have dignity, we have pride, and we're demanding that you respect that.
On August 28th, 200 civil rights protesters marched across the 16th Street Viaduct to Milwaukee's South Side, where blacks had not been able to live. They were met by about 5,000 angry white spectators who threw rocks, bricks, and obscenities at them.
I worked with a lot of white people at that time, and
just to march across the viaduct and, you know, as some of the things go on. And some of the people, fortunately, that I work with were actually selling bricks for a nickel to throw at the demonstrators. And if that doesn't leave a certain degree of scars and wounds, then, you know, something's wrong with you. And when I saw that, then, you know, it changed my whole philosophy about a lot of people. And I've never been able to totally get rid of it.
The protest continued for more than 200 days. The Freedom Walkers' efforts may not have been successful locally, but they did succeed at the national level.
The open housing campaign here and the national attention that it attracted helped spur passage of the Civil Rights Act of 1968, or otherwise known as the Fair Housing Act.
Back then, just to see my family being able to move into a better home, you know, was exciting. It was really great. You know, my father, he worked hard all his life. We could afford to move into a better neighborhood, but yet we couldn't. And then that day came where we could, so it was all worthwhile.
To the Promised Land was one of First Stage Theater's Wisconsin Cycle, a new play development initiative honoring the local history and heritage of our state.
To the Promised Land came about, John Daly, who's a good friend of mine, came to me and said, I've got a play that I've been working on, and I thought about First Stage because of the point of view of the play and the young people's stories being at the center of it.
This began as a project an interactive educational project to educate the kids about Golda Meir. It began there. And when Golda Meir was living in this neighborhood, it was basically a Jewish ghetto. It was where a lot of Russian Jews particularly settled. 60 years later, Golda Meir came back to the school, and of course the neighborhood had changed, and by 1969 it was a primarily, almost solidly African-American neighborhood. And a lot of the same issues that Golda's generation was dealing with, now African-Americans were dealing with in the 60s.
So when John Daly walked in my office with this idea for a play that looked at some of the civil rights struggles that were happening here in Milwaukee, and weaving that with the story of Golda Meir and her journey, it was such a logical fit. I think To the Promised Land, I anticipated it would be a really moving experience for audience members. And Sherry Williams-Pinnell, the director, and John Daly, the playwright, and the entire cast and crew more than met my expectations. I wasn't aware of how much conversation it would start. Some people would look at this play being about our differences, but for me, it's a play that celebrates our commonalities and the things that a girl like Golda had in common with a girl like Ruthie. Separated, growing up in different homes, different cultures, and different times, how much they had that was in their hearts that was still the same.
We hope you enjoyed tonight's presentation of First Stage Theater's To the Promised Land. For Milwaukee Public Television, I'm Joanne Williams.